Thank you, Bonnie and Gordon, that was great.
Get the bloods flowing?
Yeah. I will be reading today from Joshua 24, verses 1 through 3 and 14 through 25. Then Joshua assembled all the tribes of Israel at Shechem. He summoned the elders, leaders, judges, and officials of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. Joshua said to all the people, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Long ago, your forefathers, including Terah, the father of Abraham, and Nahor, lived beyond the river and worshipped other gods. But I took your father Abraham from the land beyond the river." The river is capitalized in this too. So that was a place, not just any river. "And led him through Canaan." "Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your forefathers worshipped beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your forefathers served beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us to forsake the Lord to serve other gods. It was the Lord our God himself who brought us and our fathers up out of Egypt from that land of slavery and performed those great signs before our eyes. He protected us on our entire journey and among all the nations through which we traveled. And the Lord drove out before us all the nations, including the Amorites, who lived in the land. We too will serve the Lord because he is our God." Joshua said to the people, "You are not able to serve the Lord. He is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your rebellion or your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, he will turn and bring disaster on you and make an end of you after he has been good to you." But the people said to Joshua, "No, we will serve the Lord." Then Joshua said, "You are witnesses against yourself that you have chosen to serve the Lord." "Yes, we are witnesses," they replied. "Now then," said Joshua, "throw away the foreign gods that are among you and yield your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel." And the people said to Joshua, "We will serve the Lord our God and obey him." On that day, Joshua made a covenant for the people, and there in Shechem he drew up their decrees and laws.
Move over. I gotta sit with you. I may not get up, but that's okay. Because remember, Jesus taught sitting down. This is for you guys to share. Okay? I have a bunch of questions for you. You ready? Now, Joey, what grade are you in now? Talking to the
mic. I'm in fifth grade.
And Cecilia, where are you at?
I'm in first.
First and fifth. That's pretty good. So you're getting pretty smart, aren't you? Yeah, is he getting smart, Mom? Okay. Do you have tests in school?
Yeah, spelling tests, math tests.
Okay, so if you have a test, are you supposed to study for it? Do you study for it?
Yes.
Now, what would happen if you didn't study, but you asked Mom to study for you?
Well, you have to study by yourself.
Why?
Well, it's your work.
It's your work. He's getting real smart. How about, that's the right answer. Very good. Somebody else can't study for you if you have to take the test, right? You have to get the knowledge. What about if I give Cecilia something to eat because you're hungry? Would that work?
No.
Would you still be hungry?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. And Cecilia would be full.
Yeah.
Right? Well, how about if Cecilia did something bad and I punished you? Would that be fair?
No.
Why not? You're the big brother.
Yeah, because she did the mess.
Yeah, she did the mess, so she should be punished, right? Cecilia, is there anything that you can do for your brother?
I do help him. I do sometimes tell him what game I play on the tablet.
Okay. And what do you do for your sister?
Well, sometimes I help her get food out of the cabinet.
Okay, because she's still a little too short?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Well, sometimes she climbs up on the cabinets and get it herself.
Yeah, that's...
I climb on the counter.
Oh, yeah. That could be a little dangerous, though, huh?
Yeah.
If you fall off. Now, is there anything that you can do for your mom?
Well, I could start doing my laundry.
You could. It sounds like you're not doing that now, though, huh? Is there anything, Cecilia, you could do for Mom?
Clean up my messes.
Clean up your messes. You know, sometimes there's things that only we can do, okay? Only we can study if we have a test. Only we can eat if we're hungry. But there's other times when we can help other people. So make sure that if it's something only you can do, you're ready to do it, okay? But if the time comes when there's something you can do to help somebody else, what should you do, Joey?
Help them.
You should help them. Thanks for coming up, and good to see you guys again.
Yes.
Thanks, Cecilia. Let's give a hand for our kids.
As we come to our time of prayer this morning, let us remember all those in our world that are still suffering. Let us continue to lift up the Mazzaro's extended family in their loss. Let us remember those praises that we've heard so far this morning. Let us go to our God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are truly blessed, Lord, and we thank you for each and every one of those blessings. Lord, we thank you for Marion's life, a life well lived, and a life that showed all her faith, her love of family, her love of other people, Lord. May her legacy live through each and every one of her family. We thank you, O God, for the healing that's taken place for Sally. Lord, a successful surgery, and she's home. And Lord, we know that it was your hand that orchestrated all things. Lord, we thank you for the success of our students, for Lily getting an award, for Matthew being accepted into college. Lord, we continue to lift up all of our youth as they travel in their journeys. Lord, we pray for protection for them. We pray for health for them all. Lord, we also remember all of our teachers and staff that are still dealing with a confused schedule, Lord. We pray for safety for them, for wisdom, Lord, and for health for each and every one. This day, we especially lift up Danny Lawbacher for health concerns, Lord, that you would speak into that situation. Lord, give him the right treatment that he needs and help him, oh God, be able to deal with it with his family as well. Lord, this day we continue to lift up the concerns of our neighbors and our community, Lord. For those that are dealing with addictions, Lord, we pray that you step into that situation. For those dealing with hunger and homelessness, Lord, we just pray that the right doors would be opened for them as well. And Lord, as we see the results of our election, Lord, we pray for peace. We pray for unity, for that both sides would be able to come together in some way so that our country can continue on the path of greatness. Lord, we ask you to be with all of our officials, all of our leaders throughout the country as they look to new adventures. And Lord, we can't forget to thank you for this building, this place, this sanctuary where we can gather free of any judgment, Lord, that we can sit at your feet and bear our hearts to you and get strength and encouragement for each day. So, Lord, continue to uplift us, Lord. Continue to let us see the glory of your world around us. And help us, O God, to remember all of our veterans this week for the service that they and their families have given to our country. Lord, we thank you for each and every one. And it is in Jesus' name that we do pray. Amen. Our gospel lesson this morning comes from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 25, beginning with the first verse. This morning I'm going to be doing something a little different, and that is I usually use the NIV, but this morning I'm using the NLT, which is the New Living Translation, and I hope you see the reason. Hear now Jesus as he teaches another parable. Jesus said, "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. The 5 who were foolish didn't take enough olive oil for their lamps, but the other 5 were wise enough to take along extra oil. When the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, they were roused by the shout, 'Look, the bridegroom is coming. Come out and meet him.' All the bridesmaids got up and prepared their lamps. Then the 5 foolish ones asked the others, 'Please give us some of your oil because our lamps are going out.' But the others replied, 'We don't have enough for all of us. Go to a shop and buy some for yourselves.' But while they were gone to buy oil, the bridegroom came. Then those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was locked. Later, when the other 5 bridesmaids returned, they stood outside calling, 'Lord, Lord, open the door for us.' But he called back, 'Believe me, I don't know you. So you too must keep watch, for you do not know the day or the hour of my return.' May God bless us with understanding as we look to these words this morning. Now, there are basically 3 kinds of travelers. Those who pack well for their journey. Anybody out there? Good packers? Okay. We're not going to talk about you today. But then there are those who overpack. Anybody?
Yeah.
Anybody overpack? Oh, yeah. And those who underpack.
I'm on Walmart.
Those overpackers are ready for anything. And that's fine unless they ask you to carry their luggage. They're ready for the sun, the rain, the snow, the hail, and even probably a tsunami. They have clothes and shoes for every possible weather condition, and they probably have some to share with you too, just in case you need it, for they know that other people don't pack as well as they do. They also have a medicine cabinet hidden in their luggage that can take care of sprains and strains, headaches, stomachache, earache, poison ivy, or any other allergic reaction, as well as something for insomnia and snoring. They have Band-Aids in every size manufactured, antibiotic creams or ointments to address any possible contamination. They have tweezers, cuticle scissors, nail clippers, and a sewing kit. You can never be too prepared. And you just might become someone's hero if you have it and they need it. They have sunscreen, they have aloe gel, they have lotions and potions as well. And they have food. Snacks from every food group, for you just never know when you might starve. And they carry drinks as well, because the water supply just might dry up. They also have
It's funny typos come in here. They also have OnStar. They have a GPS. They have Google Maps, just in case one of them is lying to them. They have an extra power bank, just in case the electricity goes out and they can't charge their devices. I could go on, but they just make me tired. Oh, and they're only going away for the weekend.
Yeah.
And then there's those that don't pack enough. Now, the good thing is, if they travel with one of the overpackers, then their needs are always met, right? But I've encountered, do you have an extra toothbrush? I forgot mine. And I forgot some shampoo. Can I share yours? Any chance you have some aspirin? And the list goes on and on. Now, we would all like to be perfectly prepared. Well, I think most of us would be, but perhaps I'm wrong. I like to be self-sufficient. I like to have what I need. I also hate to overpack, so there has to be some kind of balance in there. But I think that balance comes with experience. And if you're traveling to the same location, you should kind of know what you need, right? You know what you need, and you're going to pack the right way. I have to say that this last vacation tripped me up. COVID. I blame everything on COVID. But COVID tripped me up this time. And I ended up having to go to the store and buy a mug. Because the hotel was only using paper cups. And that just didn't work for coffee. And another mug was something that I really need as a souvenir, right? How many mugs do you have in your home? It's nice to have somebody else supply what you need. But our scripture lesson this morning is that's not the case. Let's remember it's a parable, and it begins with, "The kingdom of heaven is like." Jesus is saying that when the time comes, of which we do not know when that will be, some will be ready and some will not. He says that the wise will be ready and the foolish will not. That the wise have prepared for his coming, but the foolish didn't think ahead. On first reading, I thought, well, the wise are not too nice because they wouldn't share. But you see, I was looking with earthly eyes. That wasn't what Jesus was thinking. He's making it quite clear that being prepared for the kingdom of heaven is something that each of us as individuals is responsible for. We don't get to enter the kingdom on the shirt tails or the preparations of another. This is something that many still have not grasped today. There's no family osmosis, no hereditary traits that gives you a free ride into the kingdom. Your salvation is just that. It's yours. Your spouse can't earn it for you. Your parents can't earn it for you. Not even the saint of a grandmother or a grandfather can earn it to you by serving 100 years on a committee in church. You can't buy your way into the kingdom. You can't have all your friends and family and all your social media buddies pray you into the kingdom. You have to make that decision all on your own and do the work. Ready or not, there's going to be a time when that decision can no longer be made. There's going to come a time when those you love beyond a shadow of a doubt will no longer have the opportunity to make the plan. The door will be closed and they will be denied entrance. We don't like to think about tomorrow, and way too many of us are stuck in the past. We have to be forward thinkers. We have to be prepared with the necessities for our tomorrow. And what is our job as believers? Our job is to make sure those around us know the good news of Jesus Christ. It's up to us to share the good news with those who haven't heard it. But once again, they have to make the decision for themselves.
Ready or not, where will you be? Amen. Just a reminder that at the close of the benediction, the rear needs to leave. It's been noticed that there's a lot of people congregating together. Let's not spread any germs. Let's get out and not keep our social distance, okay, as we leave this place this day. And as we go, let's look to our own lives. Are we ready? Are we ready for that call from our Lord? Are we ready for His return? Ready or not, it's going to happen. And it is up to us to choose whether we are ready to enter that or not. May we be disciples in this place. May we be disciples as we leave these walls, sharing the good news with all who come our way. May God's peace, God's strength, and the courage go with us this day. Amen.